worship with us this morning. This is my very first Sunday. I'm so excited to be here with my family. I'm the Reverend Vanessa Winters, and I'm so excited to be here. And my first Sunday is Epiphany, which is an extra treat. I just have a couple things because I'm new, so I don't know all the announcements yet. But the first is that I am here in the office during the week. I will share with all of you that Monday is my day off, so I won't be there tomorrow. I try and honor that as much as possible. But the rest of the week, Tuesday through Friday, I'll be here in the office, except for a few meetings. If you need me, you can call the church and leave a message to Erica. You can call me on my cell phone. You can email me. You can send me a smoke signal. Whatever works for you. I've been asked to remind you that annual reports are due by January 11th. So if you're someone who needs to write something for the annual report, you need to do that by then. Are there any other announcements that I might not have covered that anyone needs to share?
Vanessa, the Bible study group will be meeting next week. And today, Jeannie's out. Her husband, Bob, had a pacemaker installed. And was very successful. It was the other day. She's with them.
Okay.
So we'll be meeting next week.
So Bible study will be meeting next week. That won't be the whole Jeannie and her husband.
To enjoy you after worship.
Oh, wonderful. Thank you so much. Any other announcements this morning?
Diane Kelly is celebrating her birthday today.
Oh, well, very happy birthday to Diane. She's trying to shrink over there. A very, very happy birthday to her. Thank you.
I want to vote the age.
Oh, 21?
Yeah,
that's good. Wonderful. Any other announcements? Then let us prepare our hearts and our minds to worship God.
Thank you.
Please join me in this morning's prayer of confession. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole hearts. We have not always done your will. We have sometimes broken your laws. We have rebelled against your love, and we have not loved our neighbors. Forgive us, we pray. Forgive us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. One fact does not change. God has loved you, loves you now, and will love you always. This is the good news that brings us new life. Amen. Christ under our feet, Christ within us, Christ over us, let all around us be Christ. Let us now share the peace of Christ with one another.
Found Jesus.
And I hit a star somewhere over here. Does anyone want to see if they can find it? Someone go look for it. It's in this area.
It looks like...
No,
it looks like
this. You guys are warm. Hot. Let it cold. Hot. Hot. So they followed that star and they found Jesus, right? Sometimes we have to look for things, like you guys just looked for that star, right? Sometimes they're not always right in front of our face. So I want you to remember that. You see, you did it and you have good eyesight, and that's what we need. We need people with good eyes. Yeah, to find things. And you have to tell your parents and your older friends about them because they don't always see things like you do. Okay? So can you come up here and we'll do the Lord's Prayer together? In kind of a circle? Yeah. Good job. Ready? Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our debts, and as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Now I know there's no Sunday school today, so folks can stay here. But during pre-K or K, you can go and hang out in the nursery if you want, okay? That's great.
Thank you.
Our gospel reading today is from the book of Matthew, chapter 2, verses 1 through 12. In the time of King Herod, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem asking, "Where is the child who has been born King of the Jews? For we observed his star as rising and have come to pay him homage." When King Herod heard this, he was frightened, and all Jerusalem with him. And calling together all the chief priests and scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Messiah was to be born. They told him, "In Bethlehem of Judea, for so it has been written by the prophet, 'And you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah, for from you shall come a ruler who is to shepherd my people Israel.'" Then Herod secretly called for the wise men and learned from them the exact time when the star appeared. Then he sent them to Bethlehem, saying, "Go and search diligently for the child, and when you have found him, bring me word so that I may also go and pay him homage." When they heard the king, they set out, and there ahead of them went the star that they had seen at its rising, until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw that the star had stopped, they were overwhelmed with joy. On entering the house, they saw the child with Mary, his mother, and knelt down and paid him homage. Then, opening their treasure chest, they offered him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And having been warned in a dream not to return to Herod, they left their own country by another road. This is the word of the Lord. Thank you, God. Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in my sight, O God, our rock and our redeemer.
Amen.
So today is Epiphany, which we conquered out a little bit in the children's time. The wise men, or the magi, as Matthew's original text said, followed the star. This means that Christmas is officially over. During Christmas, which I always like to remind people is a season, not just a day, celebrates the incarnation of Emmanuel, God with us. But here in the Western world, along with most of us, we celebrate an excess of giving and receiving. And although we don't find Santa Claus, Secret Santa, or Yankee Swap, I don't think you call them Yankee Swaps here, because we're not in England, the one where you get to steal other people's gifts, we don't see those in the Bible. So gifts do show up after Christmas during Epiphany. Epiphany is a festival of the revelation of Jesus, and this is the time we are given the opportunity to explore Jesus' identity as God incarnate. It starts out with a story about the great star that the Magi followed, that our young friends found this morning, that's over the creche, the manger. Despite what you see in Christmas pageants and Christmas movies and our very own creche, we don't hear that the Magi actually showed up at the stable. In fact, according to Matthew's account of Jesus' birth, there isn't a stable at all. In Matthew's gospel, we are simply told that Jesus is born in Bethlehem, most likely in the home of one of Joseph or Mary's relatives. And this is probably why most people don't read Matthew's narrative on Christmas Eve. He leaves out a lot of the details that we come to love. But in any case, even if Jesus was born in a stable, the Magi visit sometime after he is born. Matthew tells us that the Magi arrive in Jerusalem, the largest neighboring town of Bethlehem, after Jesus is born. The Magi finally arrive at a house where they are, and they find Jesus and his mother Mary. So what do we know about these characters, the Magi? They've been described as kings, sorcerers, astronomers, and wise men from the East, as many translations put it. We know that they most likely come from the mouth, based on the gifts that they bring, and that they know how to track a star. What I find really interesting is that in the original language, the Bible never tells us their gender or how many magi there were. The tradition that there are three comes from Matthew describing that there were three gifts, gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Whatever the numbers and gender of the magi might be, it did get me thinking about Christmas and the gifts that we give. There's this popular meme on the internet, which is like a picture if you don't know what a meme is. Usually it's a clever saying. And it talks about if there had been three wise women instead of wise men. And it says that they would have asked for directions, they would have arrived on time, they would have helped deliver the baby, and brought practical gifts like diapers before cleaning the stable, making a casual, and ushering babies on earth. So what about those gifts? We hear about gold, frankincense, and myrrh rather than food or diapers or cloth. Do we give practical gifts on Christmas? Do we prefer them? I still remember the Christmas my sister opened a gift that was in a box for a lamp. And you could see the disappointment. She kind of set it aside until my parents encouraged her to open it, where she found the iPad or iPod or whatever she had wanted. It seems like in the season of giving, we tend to focus more on the extravagant and the frivolous rather than the practical. It's an opportunity to indulge or give someone something that they would be unlikely to buy for themselves. It's not always just to show off, but rather to let our loved ones feel seen and understood, to try and show some thoughtfulness as we honor them in a season. But there are also exceptions that go into the gift of Christmas. My last church, and I set this church too, adopted needy families at Christmas time, and we had a charity angel tree with gift requests from mostly children that hung on branches. I'm sure you all do something similar. There would always be someone standing in front of all those tags and muttering about why a needy child would be asking for an Xbox or an iPad or a Nintendo DS. It would seem extravagant to them that someone who cannot buy their own Christmas presents would be asking for such expensive gifts. And maybe it is. But then isn't Christmas the time where we are extravagant? In this season of love and giving, we also hear people murmur about inappropriate entitlement while holding their own expensive gifts for their family. We perhaps condemn parents or grandparents for buying technological gifts for young children while they had grown up with toys that pushed the imagination. We condemn people for going into debt just to make Christmas joyful, to buy things they can't afford. But Christmas has a time of extravagant giving. It's a time of year that sharpens our senses to what we find uncomfortable, how our own resources often far exceed what others have. In the Nativity story, especially in Luke, which is usually what we hear on Christmas Eve, Mary and Joseph are portrayed as a needy family. They don't even have a place for Mary to give birth. And it's easy for us, with our Western culture of entitlement, to assume that Mary would have preferred practical gifts. This would show the Holy Family as more of a charity case, one where the contemporary church gets to decide what gifts would be appropriate for them, where they should be staying, how they should be celebrating their child's birth. We should remember that the struggle of the Holy Family is common many here in the U.S., around the world, some have even left. How we seek to help them, especially during times of tragedy and giving, can very much impact how they see themselves. So what I love about Matthew is that he offers a different story. The Magi arrive at the home where Mary and Jesus are. They do not question whether Jesus needs their gift. They do not comment on how humble or exceptional the dwelling is, whatever it might have been. Matthew never mentions it. The Magi do not ask to see his birth certificate or his green card. Remember, they were foreigners and strangers in this place. The Magi simply kneel before Jesus and offer him their gift of indulgence, of extravagance. Gold as to a king, myrrh to one who is mortal, and incense as to a god. These are gifts that show they understand who Jesus is. They understand who he will grow to be, and they honor him. With the festival of Epiphany, we move from a season of indulgence and gift-giving that has been loosely connected to the incarnation of God, to a celebration that is marked by honoring not ourselves, but our God. In this season of Epiphany and the rest of the year, what gifts do we give? How and why do we give them? And through them, do we honor the self-respecting agency of God and all of God's children? Through our gifts, do we and can we testify to who God is as the one who became incarnate among us? And in this spirit, I'd like to share a gift with you to close the sermon this morning. It's a poem called The Three Kings. It's written by Henry Wadsworth Longfellow, and he's one of the main claims to fame. He was born in Portland and attended college at Bowdoin, which is in Lundsworth, Maine. This poem includes details that aren't necessarily in the Bible, but it does capture the wonder and excitement that makes the Epiphany so special. So here it is. Three kings came riding from far away, Melchior and Gaspar and Balthazar. Three wise men out of the east were they, and they traveled by night and they slept by day. Their guide was the beautiful, wonderful star, so they rode away and the star stood still. The only one in the gray of morn, yes, it stopped. It stood still of its own free will, right over Bethlehem on the hill, the city of David where Christ was born. And the three kings rode through the gate and the guard, through the silent street till the horses turned and neighed as they entered the great inn yard. But the windows were closed and the doors were barred, and only a light in the stable burned. And cradled there in the scented hay, in the air made sweet by the breath of kine, the little child in a manger lay, the child that would become one day, of a kingdom not human, but divine. They laid their offerings at his feet. The gold was their tribute to a king. The frankincense with its odor sweet was for the priest, the paraclete, the myrrh for the body's burying. And the mother wondered and bowed her head and sat as still as a statue of stone. Her heart was troubled yet comforted, remembering what the angel had said of an endless reign and of David's throne. Then the kings rode out of the city gates with a clatter of hoofs in proud array, but they went not back to Herod the Great, for they knew his malice and feared his hate, and returned to their home by another way. In this season of Epiphany, in this season of the three Magi bringing gifts, I honor you and the gift you bring. Amen. Okay. I might not have a pen up here to write down some phrases. Oh, thank you so much. What a church. After your challenge. I do have a few the sad news to share with you before we open up for prayers and joys and concerns this morning. We offer prayer for Jennifer Neubauer and her entire family on the death of her father, Brian Radigan. We offer prayer to James Durban and her entire extended family on the death of her father, teacher Paul B. Jr., who I understand was a member here. And we offer prayer to Christina Carter and Count St. Micah on the passing of his mother, Diane Bennett. We hold all these families in prayer and think of them as they're in this time of need. Are there other prayers, crazy stories, or concerns that anyone would like to lift up this morning?
Thanks to the congregation. We kept my nephew Trey in prayer all summer long. He was battling Lyme disease and bacterial co-infection. I'm happy to report that he's doing much better. He's not completely out of the woods yet. But Jamie and her family, thank you so much for giving me this.
We lift up the recovery of Trey this morning with the appreciation of prayer on behalf of this congregation and confessors. Others, anyone would like to share?
First time I've had a catechism in the Hudson's VA, and their children go through a little bit on the left of their door, and they can go to great.
So we
all,
absolutely. So we hold the Copeland family in prayer this morning, Patty and Danny, on behalf of, in regards to the death of Grace, who was 19. It is so poignant to lose someone so young, especially following this season. And so we lift them in prayer this morning. Thank you. Others, joys, concerns. Well, then I'll share joy of the wonderful welcome that my family and I have received from this lovely community, from those who brought us food and milk and eggs and checked in on us and helped us. We're so grateful to be here among you all, and we are so excited about our new community and my ministry here. So that's a real joy. Well, then let us pray together. O God, who stands beyond both the darkness and the light, who is hidden by the names we give you and that can move in great mysteries to touch our lives, wake us from our indifference and cynicism to see your grace and to respond to it. We pray for all our brothers and sisters who stand beyond the margins of our comfort and our security, for all who have been alone in this season with affirmed love and community, for all who are homeless and jobless, for all who live in pain of body or mind. We lift up with joy this morning Trey, who has recovered from Lyme disease, and we give thanksgiving for the many prayers ascended from this community. We also offer with thanksgiving the warm and loving nature of this church community and welcoming my family into it. God, we pray for the children of this earth. Wake us again with their sense of play and wonder, their capacity to trust and forgive. We pray for all who are victims of hate and oppression, including all we have known and hurt through our blindness. Help us to reach out to others with understanding and reconciliation. This morning we hold many in our prayers, including all those listed on our prayer list. For the families who are in a time of mourning in this season, following Christmas, we lift up the Cosine family for Patty and Danny and the loss of Grace. We pray for them for perseverance in this time of great distress. For ourselves, we pray that we might find the time to consider the direction of our lives, the values and people we cherish, and discipline ourselves to be more intentional as agents of hope, as channels of their grace, and as people who have seen your presence in their lives. Hear our prayers this morning as they are prayed in the name of Jesus. Amen. Thank you. Sorry, I'm trying to find my notes here. This morning in the season, we're now going to move into our sacrament of Holy Communion this morning. I need to get myself. So please join me in our service of communion as we follow along. May God be with you.
May God be with you.
With your heart.
And with your heart.
Let us give thanks to the God who loves.
We give thanks and praise. Faith,
Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. Dear God, be transformed. You transform all that is before you so that at the touch of your grace, we are never the same. Dear God, you illuminate. You bring light to all people, light to the nations, light unto our hearts, light on your way. Dear God, we pray for your Spirit. Transform, illumine, bless. Make these ordinary gifts of bread and cup into the extraordinary presence of Christ with us. In so doing, hold us as your own. Renew us as your people for the sake of the world we love. For all glory and honor are yours, O God, through Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit in your glorious creation, both now and forever. Amen. All are welcome to receive from this table. We ask that you wait until all have received, and then we will take it together. Thank you. brothers and sisters in faith, the cup of blessing given for you. Amen. Let us pray. We have been fed, holy one, by your presence.
We have been fed, eternal one, by your light. Take you back to the flow, now and forevermore. Amen.
As the wise men shared your gifts with the infant Jesus, so too we gather this morning to offer our gifts of time and treasure to God. This morning's offering will now be.
Thank you.
God to all that you are searching for. Remember the gifts that you have given, and more importantly, the gifts that you still have to give. Go in peace. Amen.
Amen.